Yeah. Hey, Brian, what's up, man? What you got for us? Did you do your, are you live? Are you restreaming us right now? Yes, you are. Okay.
Yeah, I just hopped up to like officially restream it. Like, and I was going live to have a reconciliation with Snapu, and I did like a music warm up on a second channel, which I wouldn't mind building up. So I was sending people over there to do some music. I ended up having a conversation with one of these sectors, like a black dude from this Mo 3 sector. Mo 3, I guess, is the rapper. I'm learning about what these sectors are and how these things got created. And so basically, he had a reconciliation with Snapu on that other channel. I was just doing my thing on mine. I didn't know you were live or what was going on. So, but it's interesting because they got a lot of beef in their community. They were saying maybe I could be like a neutral ground. And even Paul would obviously be better to help them work out their beef. Paul could be like a neutral party in it. So we'll see. We'll see where this shit all goes. Now we got, now I guess, Ben Thorpe and Grace, we're doing black panels in the past from what I hear. So I was just playing a clip of them talking about black panels and how they prefer them over the white panels. So that's just interesting.
Yeah, Brian, you act like there wasn't a time where I wasn't doing that, going over there surrounded by black folks and then us having great conversations. And then sometimes they fucking do the, you're an automatic racist game. So this is nothing new. You know, it's kind of something that seems to be, I don't know. I guess intriguing to folks, because I know that, you know, when I was doing it, the numbers would, you know, would go up and it'd be kind of a high energy in conversation. So yeah, man, I think it's a good bit, if you want to call it that.
Yeah. So he was just trying to, this dude, Donald Goings, he came over, he was trying to say that like they were going through like this 90-day period where all people, a bunch of people were coming up that looked like me that were horn bombing them and shit. So they're a little, so he was just trying to like give me a background as to why they might be, because I was like, cause I was telling him, he's like, you're chopping up. I'm like, bro, there's just a lot of the racism being exposed on these black panels. And then he's just trying to like let me know why they might be reacting the way they are. So
what are your thoughts on Hard Hat being a complete two-faced cowardly bitch and then copping out and showing he's disingenuous like everyone he's now hanging out with?
Yeah, man, he like that's the new, that's the narrative going around, that I'm just your bitch, you treated me like shit forever. And like to have that,
well, they're
shit.
Doing that purposely to try to affect the power structure they see forming. This is what the demons do, is they try to establish, the predators try to establish a power structure and what might affect them, and then they try to look for where it's weak, and then they try to expose that weakness or attack that weakness. So you're going to get a lot of that, right? If you start seeing that you deferring to me like others have done is going to get you the claims that you're my bitch and all the rest of it, rather than them accepting that you have accepted that I may have something to offer you. I'm not detracting from you and what you're doing. That's not my intention. So they want to get you to compete with me. They want to get you to break the link of conversation and power structure. Inherently, you could argue it's an inherent hierarchical power and value system. It's the same thing that got a whole bunch of people over to my channel to begin with when I was on an Android in a tent, right? So the same thing that's happening with you has happened with me, and you're going to have to see self as self, and then you're going to have to recognize all the other selves who don't see that and want to attack what they believe to be a difference or a division to try to expose that and make you operate from that position, right? So there's a lot of games that these demons like to play in life, and especially on here. Is they're clutching for power, they're clutching for numbers, they're clutching for money, they're clutching for an identity. They want to be seen and heard and validated, right? So, you know, just be aware of that shit, bro. The power games that everybody plays. I mean, I'll say the same thing for me. If I start playing them, we talk privately, right? So all you got to do is come to me privately and go, listen, bro, I don't like the way you're handling this, because it seems like you're doing XYZ, and I'll give you my perspective and we could talk it out, right? So, you know, that's how you do this shit, you know, with certain people who you can trust on some level or you see have good intentions. The rest of folks, you can't talk to them privately because they'll try to hit you up and try to fuck with you in your movement.
Yeah, well said. What say you, Snapu?
I think Paul just nailed it, discernment, because you really didn't tell the full story about what happened. I actually went warthog creature in defense of O'Shea today, because the black guy that he had on panel at first was kind of questioning O'Shea in a investigative questioning. You a mole, you a this, you that. But then he made a statement saying all white, only white people porn bomb. And I kind of went snafu creature and fucking defended O'Shea. I think discernment is a big thing. The power games, I think you'll get it, O'Shea. But crew and O'Shea,
and I had a conversation. Let's be clear, just so you're in the know of like how I perceive it, and then Brian can give his perspective, obviously. Me and him had a conversation last night about you privately, and I just said to him, listen, let me just get to it. So I just said to him, listen, in any one of these people's interactions, you got to try to see self as self, you know, even if you got to love them from a distance. And part of your pattern, like a lot of folks here, is foster care, broken home, abandonment issues, loss, codependency, shit like that. Right. So yeah. I believe that was part of why you were acting out like we all do at times, because really, I think that you want to be a part of what's going on. Really, I think that you want to be included. You know, I really think that it's folks don't like to come on here and privately or publicly say that. And then when they don't get that, they want to act out from a place of past dysfunction. Right. So folks love you here. They care about you. They want you to be included. I'm not interested if you feel uncomfortable with folks saying that and showing that. You may need more of that because it's precisely the thing you won't accept. Right. And maybe once you get more of that or feel more of that or have more of that, you won't act out as quickly when you feel like you're not being included or accepted. Because I don't think that's what it was. He, like me, was tired of the yelling, the interrupting, the nonsense, and he's trying to have conversations and do his own thing. He doesn't need people to be part of that. Just like I don't all the time, right? So like Slow State last night will say, Jack needs to teach Paul how to fill out panels. He forgets I came on here with full panels every day. I got tired of it. He thinks that I want what he wants at this time. I don't want 15 jerk-offs around me every day, chattering and yammering and talking over me and making me fight for airtime. I'd rather be by myself or with one or two or a select group of folks who can show up every day, contribute to the conversation, yield to my insanity, and not take it personal. And that's hard to fit that bill, right? There's only a few folks who can fit the bill of what I need. So the rest just kind of become content or they get thrown. It's because just the way it has to move, bro.
Because the other people are ego driven. I believe that when they say that they've had their spiritual awakening, for me, when I see that they're ego driven, it shows to me that they know you didn't learn how to kill your ego. It's like the Hulk. All right. Okay. I'm going to use a weird analogy, right? But at one moment in one of the Avengers movies, one of the Avengers asks Bruce Banner what his trick is. And I believe it was Tony Stark. And he says, how do you do it? How do you transform? How do you like keep control over it and everything? And he eventually tells him, he goes, it's because I'm always angry, right? So he had already canalized that energy into being able to control the Hulk, because, well, it's the same type of dynamic when it comes to perceiving how you're showing yourself, you know?
OCW, this is the point, is you're on it again. And they don't understand why I fuck with you. It's not about the numbers and the false value, right? I put the import on the true value, which is self-development, self-understanding, discernment, and then the content, right? So, like, I've killed off my ego in the sense of what I want and don't want on here, because I came in with what I want and don't want, and none of it happened. So I had to go with what is in the moment, right? And that's precisely what they don't do with me and others on here when they're supposed to, and then they want to claim it's my ego. No, it's yours, because you have an image of how this is supposed to go, and it never goes that way. And instead of you just yielding to the current and going where it needs to go or where it's meant to go, you keep resisting it so it persists. You guys aren't awakened. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You have little to no self-knowledge, application in the world, and results. And then you want to come on here with your false self and personality and false image and try to upkeep a narrative that's not going to be kept up. It's like trying to keep the beach ball in the air. At some point, it's going to hit the ground.
Yeah.
So just learn how to respond when the ball hits the ground. Stop trying to keep it in the air. It's a fruitless endeavor.
Right. And to bring it back to to the Wait a minute, Snaps. And to bring it back to the ego analogy is, in other words, I've learned from my actual spiritual awakening, okay, from my personal experience, that I have the same kind of talent as Bruce Banner, as being able to canalize that anger. I am able to have an absolute control over my ego at all times. And someone who's actually spiritually awakened has that ability and is able to
see. Right, I've seen it with you. I saw it with me from the beginning. You were able to get angry, but it did not influence your decision making. So you were able to scream and yell and let the dog off the leash, but not have to ban, block, throw people out, make false judgments. That's the point. You can have the emotional content. If you're content with yourself and your life on some level or working toward that, emotional content is good. If you want to call it emotional, right? Energy in motion. The problem is when during or after that, you believe something must happen and then you force it to happen, right? And then they want to equate me and what I do with that. No, I'm telling you, if we can't do that process together here off screen, I just cut you out of my existence. That's not the same thing as using a hammer for every nail, you know, being the problem, right? We have one tool in the box. No, I have many tools in the box. I've shown that. But when it comes down to what needs to happen next and the quality of the broadcast, that's what I put first, right? It's not even my wants and non-wants.
Well, it's
I came into this, if you go back, I wanted to start community. I was using this place as a beacon to bring folks on the land, I thought, to actually create solutions for slavery we face on the ground. It did not happen. It happened, but it didn't. I got who I needed, who were resonating with me, who are still there in my life, who we seemingly can co-create on some level. But the majority of these interactions on here went a whole other direction, and I had to just work with that.
But you had a positive impact over onto my own life and my actual fucking interactions with people now. Because I never knew where to draw the line before.
Here we go, OTW. She's doing it now.
I fucking draw the line now. I fucking tell people how it is, what it's about, what's going to happen, and how I want things to be from now and forward on. And I am actually be able to stand on that and say, look, if you can't fuck with that, then you just don't come. Don't show. Don't talk to me. Don't fuck with me. Don't fuck with me. Don't just like fucking ignore me. Get out of my life. I don't need you. If you're willing to
Skylark is doing it now with the synchronicity, right? This is precisely the irony. Like some guy in my Telegram last night goes, it's almost as if the reality machine identified that Paul was going to make some change or difference. So it just created a whole bunch of simulation characters to come in, get next to him, water down the message, and create false drama to take him off the path that he was projected to be on. I go, holy shit, this guy just spoke what I've been experiencing.
I need to. Jack is in fucking Brian's chat now, like a fucking bitch, because he can't. He's not here in art. Now he's fucking commenting over.
Because he doesn't have any control over himself or the venue, so he knows he's already lost. That's why he won't come in here. He knows he can't make a point. He knows he has no value in his life. He can't converse and create conversion. He's failed over and over again with everyone in his life. So now he has to take an insulated position where he gets no responsibility and obligation, just like he's done with the house and in his life. He does the same thing in every aspect of his life and doesn't understand you are who you are in everything you do with anyone you do it with. That's why you're surrounded with people just like you with the same results. That's why when Skylark says it's called flow, I laugh that a man calls himself flow state but can't achieve that state of consciousness and then resist someone who can and has.
Right. And it's up or out, Jack. That's, you know, like I'll fucking repeat what O'Shea said in chat, man. You know, like it's like fucking man up, dude. Click the fucking link. Come on up here and do your shit or fucking fuck.
And let's just be honest. You were talking about flow saying full panels and shit. And let's just be honest. They're cupcaking together tribalism. They're still talking about enslavement. They're still talking
That's all it is. That's all it is tribalism, this side versus that side. And it benefits them to create that narrative, because the more you have an enemy and an outgroup, the more you can bolster your false position and get contributions and value from your power base. It's all political science movements. You folks are the collectivist, communist, Marxist, fascist, crony capitalist that you've been bred to be. All of your actions and lifestyle and reactions prove that's who and what you are subconsciously. I don't give a fuck what you consciously say. I look at who and what you are, what you do, and reverse engineer that. And it's one for one. Use the same tactics and the same projections and the same reactions with the same intentions for the same outcome as your masters. And it's fucking embarrassing and pathetic, and that's why you will fail. And even if you get to some limited worldly power and success, you will undo yourself because you're a child of the devil, a child of the lie.
You don't really want to be free. You want to be like Cypher in the Matrix, and you want to fucking be, you want to go back into the Matrix and fucking, you know, and forget that, you know, there's another reality out here that we can all fucking live and be happy and you know, live off the land. No, everybody wants to be a fucking enslaved motherfucker who doesn't really want to appreciate life for what it really is and all the value that we could actually bring to it. If we all really, you know, banded as one and, you know, created an actual outcome that will lead to prosperity and fucking something and a greater outcome than the one that everybody is like fucking fear porning about.
Oh my God. Did you guys read what Jack just wrote? He says, wanting community, but OTW censored me or all this other shit. Jack.
I'm not getting it, bro. We could want community, but it has to be with people who we resonate with, who have vision and discernment and want self-mastery and self-knowledge and growth. You're not that. You're the absence of that. You could never be part of the community. If I first of all, I offered you, Jack Talcott, to come down on the land to see what you'd say. What did you respond with? You think my life's going to be summed up by working on the land? Like you're too good for that. Go fuck yourself. Wow. If you came down here and you said that to me and other people in the desert, we'd fucking leave you there, metaphorically. Okay? There's a lot of room in the desert for a piece of scum like you. You have the nerve to insult me and the Mexican folks I'm working with who are building something and creating something on the land. They're doing more than me. The difference between me and you is I'm not so fucking self-righteous and egotistical that I would have the balls to tell them I'm going to do less work. I had them tell me. I said to the guy the other day, yeah. I said, listen, bro, I really appreciate what you've helped me with and provided with for me to have this opportunity. And I've not done as much as I probably should or could. He goes, what do you mean? He didn't even see it that way. I see it that way because I take account for myself and what I've done and not done. He spent a ton of money. He fucking worked his balls off. And I was sitting in a camper broadcasting 6 to 8 hours a day. And there's no reason for it. There's no reason that I could have taken 2 to 3 hours out a day and did more outside. But I really am not that. I'm not a person who wants to do that. And I've already had to teach myself by doing landscaping for a year how to bust my own fucking balls outside and get credibility in that venue. So when you lack credibility in a venue, you don't respect yourself, nor should you. And it doesn't even matter if others do. You don't for yourself because it's called authenticity and accountability. And that's what allows you to grow. So I set an intention this year to go out there specifically to do what I know needs to be done, because if not, I don't eat. Because if they collapse this fucking economy and I have to eat the fucking food that these Mexican folks grew, right? And I'm saying that to be triggering in a sense. I don't see a division there. The point is, if I have to eat that fucking food and they're not going to take fiat coupons, what am I going to tell them? Oh, Pauly Boy was an E-list YouTube star. He couldn't work the field and now he wants to eat with his fat ass and he's got nothing to offer. I better hope he's willing to take guns and ammo, whatever the fuck else I got lying around. Or guess what? I don't fucking eat. You got to earn your fucking keep in this world. Something I didn't want to accept and learn, and I still struggle with it. You won't even look at it and accept it, let alone right your fucking wrongs. You're pathetic and embarrassing. You're not a man, and that's why your woman and child left you, and you've been thrown out of every fucking job you've been a part of, because you're a skunk and a snake. And you claim high ground when you're the lowest living form of life. That's right. What's worse.
You can't be a fucking life coach and a fucking guy who's pushing the fucking cupcake bullshit. And
bro,
and,
he's never been a life coach. No, but let's just be real. Do that,
all right, and actually not be able to put your ego under your foot. Absolutely.
OTW, they say I'm Colton. These are people who look at me at times like I'm God almost, the way they speak to me. And I got to tell them, whoa, whoa, whoa. I'm just a guy talking on YouTube. I'm just upholding the law. I'm just a good talker. Relax with all that. You need to hold me accountable. We ain't going to Talcott me. Oh, I'm too big and good and white. that I can sit in a trailer and broadcast online. I don't have to do any fucking work on the ground. You set me up like that, that's okay, and it's going to fuck me long term. I don't want that. I don't need that, nor do I want it. Because I know what the fuck I need, even if I don't know what the fuck I want. So I'm going to move toward that, and that's accountability and humbleness and humility. Don't tell me I lack humbleness and humility when I embody it in every fucking aspect on the ground, and you've yet to.
Right.
People say to me, why are you coming to me and telling me that you're not a good enough person? I go, this is accountability for me. This is how I feel. I feel like I could have done more, and I let myself down, in a sense, let you down. Nah, Paulie, we don't feel that way. You know? Well, I feel that way. And I'd rather err on that side than err on the side of I'm too fucking good to do what needs to be done, and everyone's got to kiss my feet because you met me online and I got an audience. Bullshit. Right.
That's true, man. And a lot of people, you know, think they're like kind of like a boss, right? And that's where you're fucking getting all the fucking resistance from, right? Because they think that, you know, they can tell people what to do and how to be instead of actually looking inwards and fucking making the change and then expressing that out, you know, to other people and showing the results of the fucking change that you made for yourself. And I believe that's what Paul is doing. And this is one of the reasons why he gets so much hate, because so many of you are fucking looking for your fucking, your treasure, whatever the fuck, on the outside.
Yeah, because I'm not willing to bullshit myself or be bullshitted by other frauds and liars and deviants. So, because I'm not willing to bullshit myself and go back to living like that, they are in resistance to me because that's all they live day after day. Can't understand why I would or wouldn't do that.
I can't believe he gave, well, I can believe he'd say some dumb shit like that. It's like but what he said in the comments just now, like, you guys want community, but you're dictators, basically, is always about. It's just
you.
Unbelievable.
That's you.
Yeah.
Let's do the that's you where it's appropriate. That's you. I mean, I need a dictatorship for to trick myself out of doing what needs to be done so I can get fatter and more complacent and comfortable and pathetic like you? You look like you're ready to die. You're losing all your fucking hair like Obama in the White House. Give me a break.
Even
fucking Mexican really guy I work with, a brick fucking house. You go to grab him like this. I grabbed him a couple months back on his shoulder, you know, to fuck with him. Guy's like a brick fucking house. And he's the most loving and caring man. And he'll probably put a bullet in you, too. So I'm not interested in living like you or being around scum like you. Because you're fucking embarrassing, weak, and pathetic on all fronts. Physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. You're fucking cowardly and weak. You know it, I know it, Dominic knows it, and your fucking wife that headed for the hills knows it. And that's the difference between you and me. Every motherfucker around me knows I'm the antithesis of that.
Just be real. Even his fucking cupcake motherfuckers, like the Provo and they know he's full shit. They know he's fucking delusional. They're just playing him. They're playing onto the fucking clout, the bullshit. Because no, a real friend or real person is going to say, you're delusional, dude. You're fucking out of your mind. All these fantasies are fantasy. And even he's had that. A lot of his own people are starting to tell him that, but they still push him up and feed that bullshit
fantasy. They can do whatever they want, bro. You still got to be you at the end of the day and get your results. I don't. They do too. So sit in your fucking stench together and claim it to be, you know, all rosy. You want to do the rose-colored glasses game that all you codependents and addicts like to do? Go ahead and do it. I've already walked this walk on the ground. I've already addressed my codependency. I've already addressed my rose-colored glasses and my ignorance, right? I've already addressed that my way doesn't work at one time because it got me the results I had. That sucked. You haven't done any of that work yet. You're a bunch of addicts and codependents online, and you've yet to do the process of recovery in any sense. You just switched addictions. Slavery's your addiction. Genocide's your addiction. Tribalism's your addiction. Dopamine hits for views is your addiction. Get real. $20 extra a month is your fucking addiction because you're the man and woman now. Give me a break. All you folks, you're the same as me. The difference is I've looked at me and reordered that and realigned that on some level and got different results. You haven't looked at it yet. And you have the nerve to want to address me. You can't even self-analyze. Stupid, simple motherfuckers, and you got the balls to think you're going to analyze others? Boy, is the arrogance high on here, huh?
Oh, yeah. That's That's an understatement.
Some that can't even pass a standardized test to go get the damn degree to do it. They couldn't even do that. Get the fucking menial degree to go and practice what the fuck you preach. No, you can't, because you're an incompetent, you're incapable, you're procrastinating, you're lazy, you're codependent and addictive. And what's worse, you're ignorant and arrogant. You don't even believe you need to do any of that. You don't even believe it applies to you. You're just going to fake it till you make it, huh? Good luck with that. Love to see what you come up with. Don't think you're going to be able to do it better than me. I'm a better talker. I'm a better bullshitter when I was bullshitting than all you skunks and scum. If I couldn't get it done, living that way, I don't think you're going to be able to, because I'm better than you at that too.
Right. And that's one thing, you know, my mother could always call me out for when I was fucking talking bullshit. She'd actually sing a song to me. She goes like, bullshit. He sings it all day long. Bullshit. It was his favorite song. Bullshit. She sang that directly.
Right. They've been telling me in every venue from the beginning, why don't you become a lawyer or something and apply this fucking natural ability you got to just question and to analyze self and others. My principal told me, I was fucking, 14 years old? He goes, the biggest difference I see with you and the rest of these folks is you can say who and what you are and everyone else, while everyone else is in their own delusion. I go, oh, yeah, I know where I'm a piece of shit. I've just owned it. I own the position.
Yeah.
He couldn't argue with me. I said, bro, I'm going to show up here every day. I'm going to cut class, go out back, smoke dope. I'm going to make jokes in the back of the room because I don't see any value in what goes on here, and I'm forced to be here. Sorry that you don't like that. And I know it's not like favorable for you guys in your business, but this is who and what I am, and I don't see another way around it. He goes, I can't really argue with you. You just can't really be doing this here because it reflects bad on me. I go, well, it's not your problem. It's my father's problem. It's their problem. They can't corral me. They can't control me. And I'm not interested in being misled by you people. I don't want to be like you. I've been telling this story since 12 years old, 14 years old. They can't even argue with me because they don't want to be them at their job doing what they're doing. I said, we're bonding now. I don't want to be here and be part of this, and you don't want to have to babysit me and chase me. He finally just left me to fuck alone, and I did what the fuck I wanted, and they'd suspend me. I go, listen, this is real simple. You guys' biggest punishment is putting me in suspension away from all the chimpanzees and noise and nonsense. I can actually get work done there. So I just do my work in suspension and kick my heels up the rest of the day and talk shit, or I leave. Because you can't really physically stop me anyway. I'm bigger than most of these people, even at my age at one time. And you can't put hands on me. And I know that. And I'm not going to take no for an answer. So I'm going to do all the work 3 hours in. And I'm just going to get up and leave for the last 3 hours. And I don't give a fuck what you write down in your little booklet. The joke was when they would test me, they'd say, this guy's more intelligent than all the rest of the kids here. We don't understand what's going on. I go, I don't either. I'm broken. I hate me. I hate my life and my family. I don't want to be. And they would tell me every year, oh, it's going to get harder. You can't get by on just your intelligence and scanning the questions ahead of time or the material and then picking out knowing what we're going to ask. I go, sorry, I'm smarter than you and know what you're doing here and got the program figured out. Sorry, you can't indoctrinate me. So I get 90s on all the tests without studying by just scanning the material, knowing what the fuck they're going to do and how they think. And they tell me, it's going to get harder. No, it didn't get harder. The only thing that got harder was living like you people and being a part of your fucking system. Your crap was very easy. It was not challenging. It did not test me. It did not force me to grow and become better. It was menial, lukewarm, mediocre, and embarrassing. And that's why most people nowadays can't walk and talk and chew gum. Their writing is atrocious. Their speech is abominable. Their life looks like a fucking sham and a joke. And they're not proficient in anything they do because they really don't give a fuck. They're just another placeholder like the people who brought them up in those systems. That's the difference between me and you again, by the way. So you're not going to gaslight me that all my qualities are detriments. It's worked out great for me, horribly for you. And we're not switching positions again. That's over.
Right. You see, I've been chasing that false fucking dream that everybody's been, went to school for and everything. And I always thought that was actually the reality that I wanted. When I came to the realization through the past fucking year in my interactions here, that's not what I want at all. That's not what my heart desires. So I've actually been able to come back to what my heart really wants, right? And that's what's most important. It's what your heart desires. It's what's your fucking, what's guiding you is God. God is living in your heart. So you got to listen to your heart, man. That's how it,
dude, they eventually, because they were holding me back because I'd never show up and I'd ace all the tests. They eventually changed the whole curriculum and just let me do school the way they should have from the beginning. They just gave my father and me all the work and just had me do it on my own time. Cause I have ADHD. You know, I'm like weird like that, where when I'm surrounded by a bunch of other pathetic slaves who are retarded and projecting, I'm not as easily able to focus. I'm strange like that. So when you put me in a fucking room and you give me the stack of work, I just do it in 2 hours and go out my fucking life. Why are you dragging this out? So we just did a whole year's worth of work to get me the fuck out of there one day and pass 5 tests within a week and it was over. Why are we doing this? For what? I'm not retarded like the rest of them. Let me go. Let my people go. The non-retarded ones, let my people go. We could do your 4 years of garbage in 1 year and we could be on with the rest of our fucking life. And I could have learned how to fucking start a business and be successful and be like responsible and accountable and fulfill obligations. You know, a life school instead of playing this indoctrination camp game with you people. But that's the point of it. That's why the schools look just like jails when you put them side by side photos. It's not about the curriculum. It's not about the self-knowledge. It's not about becoming successful. It's about being a good kept pet indoctrinated slave. And we know that at this time. I was just ahead of my time. That's all that was. What else is new? Isn't that the recognition of genius? It's just constantly being ahead of your time and having people tell you you're fucking sick and twisted and crazy and don't know who and what the fuck you are. So let us tell you while you don't want to be like us. I'm pretty sure that's the prerequisite. Pretty sure that's something a lot of us have in common here. This is not a speech about how great I am, in case you got lost.
Yeah, and that's exactly, you know, it resembles pretty much how I was, how it went for me at school. And I quit school. It was, I was like 15 and I started fucking working, right? Working in restaurants, washing dishes and shit. And I started, you know, realizing when I went back to school, it took me a week to get my high school degree, right? A week, 5 days. And I had it. I passed the test. It was all, I had like six exams to do, was to get your high school degree. And then I actually went to college. Because I figured that was the path that I was supposed to go. So I went into logistics because I knew that I had a keen sense of how to fucking fix problems and shit. And I was really good at it. And I was, you know, so I figured, you know, this is where I want to go. And I ended up realizing that, no, even in that fucking particular venue, you have fucking sharks and people that are fucking stupider in power positions that'll actually put you in certain situations to fucking get you fired so they can keep their position so you don't fucking steal their position because you're fucking doing a better job than them and you're actually bringing some value to the company and that person's just sitting around fucking playing on their phone and not bringing anything and just sitting there fucking getting paid and seeing you on your come up and make sure that you don't fucking surpass that person. So it's a fucking jungle out there anyway. Even if you do want to go into, so you need to fucking find your real space, what your real value is, and bring that to the table. And then you try as hard. This is what I've been trying. This is my journey. I've been trying to, and it's trying because I haven't been successful at it yet. So eventually it's going to come. I know, I feel it. I understand that I have this path. I have experience to go through and things that are going to make me become what I really want to be in life, which is an artist and do everything I can to be in that venue, whether it be in broadcasting and music. If ever I have a chance to have a real job or something that would, you know, put my fucking talents into fucking perspective, you know, and actually get remunerated for it, you know, to live off of yourself instead of living off of some other fucking guy's company.
Right, but that's why you again, we're back to you reinvest in yourself and start to learn who and what you are by applying self to different situations. Right? All you have to do is look at the landscape and see that on some level, I'm not claiming to be necessarily completed or proficient or whatever, but on some level, I've amalgamated a whole bunch of different positions into one position for me. Right? It's like psychology, it's sociology, it's anthropology, it's entertainment, it's like carnival barker. right? It's you know, keeper in a sense, jail keeper, right? I mean, like, you know, sanitation, taking out the trash, right? Sweeping the street, so to speak. I mean, how has this position on YouTube not embodied like 10 or 15 different societal positions that go on every day to some degree? And then we can go into those fields and argue I'm probably better at some of them in those fields who have the paperwork and the, you know, supposed institutional achievement, right? It's just this is the idea from the beginning of time of jack of all trades, master of none, many times better than a master of one. A human being who has self-knowledge has knowledge of the universe. They can pretty much take that to any venue and excel to some degree, because it's about the way you think. It's not about what you've been taught to think being spit back out. So again, you in this life, especially as an American, in quotes, we understand the role of rugged entrepreneurialism, individualism. And what that means is you don't go into a society and let them pigeonhole you to a position. You create a position for yourself on the outskirts where you can embody all things at all times. That's a godlike beingness, right? Do you want to be an NPC or do you want to be made in the image of the Most High? Someone who's made in the image of the Most High says, build it and they will come. I'll create a position for myself with this truth in 10 venues while doing none of them at all.
Right. Because God didn't say to live your truth. He said to live His truth, okay? And He didn't say either to focus on what was it?
You're on it. This culture and society identifies with specialization, and their idea of specialization is pigeonholing themselves to exploring one aspect of the truth. That's their shortcoming. With specialization comes a limited paradigm, because right. You're not a holistic person with a holistic view. So by institutionalizing everyone and forcing everyone into pigeonholed specialization, they lack the overall vision. They can't see the border around the frame. So it regularly causes them to have flawed hypothesis and results.
It's like He didn't say to love with your love. He said to love as Christ loves, you know. So this is the thing. People get things convoluted and they always bring it back to themselves when it's actually bringing it back to God. You know, because it's all there. It stems from Him, from the beginning. It's like even I come to the understanding that even everything I see is actually a projection that God is projecting for me. He's doing it for me.
Right. This is why the story of the Christ of being was a healer, you know, a pastor, you know, an on-the-ground warrior, you could argue, right? It was basically the archetypal being who could fill all positions and none of them at once, because He was beyond the system, beyond the world, beyond the specialization, beyond the pigeonhole paradigm. This is cosmic consciousness. These folks are living in and of the world, specialized in institutionalization, indoctrination, and can't understand why their results are flawed. You can't be a good man in business or your profession if you're not a godly man first. This is what this culture and society has missed.
Your thoughts, Brian?
Yeah, this is all great stuff. I'm getting a lot out of it. I think the audience is getting a lot out of it. Happy with the momentum and the path that I'm on and the process I'm on right now. So things are feeling good at the
Congratulations
moment.
Congratulations to you, Brian, and everything you're embarking on in your journey. That, you know, I'm following it and I'm thinking it's interesting. It's actually very inspiring, to tell you the truth. And it actually got me back indirectly into my own particular investment in my own talents and what I'm able to do and what I can really excel at. And I'm thinking of putting a lot more time into it. It's one of the reasons why I did not broadcast yesterday, right?
Yeah, man, that's I appreciate that, man. It's good to hear. It's like there's like that free energy thing with this inspiring one another. There's like an abundance, there's a prosperity, there's a what do they call it? Exponential growth like the more you get inspired and inspire others and they inspire others, you know, it's going to push us towards that 100 monkey tipping point to where, because I was talking to some cats, you know, I was forced to talk, to hang out with comedians because I had to wait in line for an hour to get the guest spot at the club. So there's a group of comedians out there and I'm explaining the situation with the arrest. And I, through the process of explaining it to them, I was like motivating myself and I almost like understood more about what I'm doing. Like, cause I was like, yo, I got these plates on, which is kind of a mistake if I'm going to not hand the ID, because it's like, I'm trying to play both worlds. I'm trying to play public and private.
Right. And you're actually even playing with fire when you come to think of it, right? You're actually tempting the devil.
So when I got my arrest, even though it's been a hugely positive experience for me, through explaining it to these comedians who have no clue what I'm talking about, I began to get more understanding. I was like, because I'm like, you guys are in the public, right? You guys got all these things. I'm like, you guys decide to be slaves and shit. Like, that's fine. There's millions of slaves. And like, I'll tell the cop, like, tell them truthfully, you might want to just leave me alone, like, because I'm on something different. But the fact that I have those plates on, I lose like some of my stance grounding. So unless I take the plates off, you know, I got some things to think about. And but it's just a learning experience. And
you know, but I think, like, Brian, you know what I think the only thing that you would be missing, if you take the plates off, have the documentation on hand that stipulates, like, you put the officers on notice right off the bat with that documentation stipulating who and what you are. That way, at least you'll have something. Like Paul, when he interacted with the police, he had documentation. Many of the interactions that I've watched, the people that are there have their documents ready on hand, and they are actually ready for the interaction, right? So I do understand that you want to be able to be vocal with the officers, but I do believe that you have, if you would have the documentation with you, that would actually help you a lot. In the sense of credibility, I'm speaking, right? The officers will take you a tad more seriously, I believe.
The ideal situation would be to either have like a DOT tag or whatever, no tags, and then have some, like they, what are they talking about? The passport, like correcting their status, like going through that process. But for me, it's like, step one is like, the process is in with me. So have me embody it. Like the paperwork, because it's like, oh, I don't need fucking paperwork, but at the same time, it's good to have it. I understand that, but
right. It's like another tool, man. It's not something, it's necessary. Like I said, like you said, it's like, no, it's not a necessary thing, and you shouldn't have something that you should necessarily lean on. You should be able to lean on yourself. But like I said, it's like a musician without an instrument. You know, he's still a musician. He can sing, but I mean, I guess it's like, you can't do what you can do when you have the extra tools. You know, you can push things a little bit further and have a lot more credibility. And especially when you're like filming it, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're putting this out onto YouTube and stuff. It brings a little bit of more professional aspect to it, I believe. But then again, this is like constructive criticism and not putting down what you've already done and accomplished up until now, which I am fucking like, you know, two thumbs up even. So
yeah, and it's like, you know, like the holographic simulation aspect of it, like, where else in my life do I have one foot in, one foot out, trying to play both sides, not just fucking not giving a fuck and going for it one way? That can apply in all areas of life, right? So
right, because I've seen, like, I was able to get like jobs without having to have that CV, the curriculum vitae, right? And around these parts, you know, a lot of people focus on that and they keep asking you, you know, like, let's say you're going to look for a job and they keep asking, do you have a CV? And I was like, what do I need a CV for? It's like, what's that for? It's like a piece of paper with a bunch of bullshit written on it. It's like, I'm a worker, I'm here to work. And, you know, put me on the fucking, you know, on the ground. I'll show you what I can do. And then you be the judge of it. You know, it's not a piece of paper that's going to show you who and what I am and what I'm going to do, right? For you. So it's like, So I've never really been like, I've always leaned on myself for anything I've ever really wanted, especially when it comes to like a work or a job, and or the same thing as an entrepreneur, where I had to go out and chase my own jobs and do the you know, go knocking on doors and fucking getting the roof jobs. Every time I'd see a fucking roof, a shingle roof all fucking finished, I'd fucking stop right away, go fucking knock on a door, ask them, you want a quote for your roof? And I started my own business like that, you know, because I didn't want to depend on some other guy to give me a job. I wanted to be able to go out there and do it myself, you know. So
yeah, man, kind of lost in my thoughts.
You know, at my age, it's like, man, I'm not cut out for roofing anymore, you know. I think I put the years in. I'm good. It's like maybe once in a while, but every day, no, can't do it anymore.
Yeah, you never know when we get to this land and shit. People, these tiny homes.
I'm at a point where
I build in your own home, you know.
Yeah, I could teach people how to roof, though. That would be lucrative, and I wouldn't mind going to that direction. You know, teach people how to roof.
Yeah, like they end up building a bunch of tiny homes. You could like be like my supervisor kind of guy, so teaching people or whatever, teaching the younger, more able people to fucking craft.
Because that was something I was actually good at when I'd hire people or you know, like new roofers that never actually put their foot on the roof. I fucking actually really teach them to become fucking awesome roofers, man. Even to the point where they'd actually start their own businesses. I've had a few guys that were under my wing that started their own fucking businesses, and they still have it today. And it's very, really impressive. And I'm in like, in all that because I fucking gave them a chance and showed them how to make their own money, you know. So showed them how to sell jobs and everything, man. I showed them even how to fucking discern if the person was going to sign the contract or not. I was actually that good. In 5 minutes, I could tell you if the client that I was dealing with would sign the contract or not.
This is going to apply to this skill of teaching how to someone to be at the top of the game. Like, you know, as you pursue these other things, broadcasting, different things in entertainment, maybe that's a transferable skill. Like other people coming up with broadcasting, other people trying to music or whatever type of entertainment, you know, you could maybe at some point you'll be working with others in a similar way. Oh, you know what I'm saying? Just helping people bring the best out of people. You know? Get people trained up.
Yeah.
Skills. It's skill becomes.
You know what? Verily says there's got to be a way to get over it. You know what's fucking, that's ironic because I'm fucking afraid of heights. The first fucking time I went up on a roof, it was a three-story building, okay? And the ladder was fucking doing like a banana and it was fucking waving while I was carrying the pack of shingles, which was 80 pounds, right? And I was going up the fucking ladder, swinging on it like that, fucking, you know, near literally pissing myself, saying, I'm never going to get on that roof with this fucking pack of shingles. So by the time I got up to the roof with the pack of shingles, the fucking ladder started fucking dipping backwards, man. And everybody's on the roof yelling at me, telling me, let go of the pack of shingles, man. And I'm like, I fucking let it go and it fucking drops like the three stories down. And the fucking ladder fucking hits back onto the roof again. And they fucking grab me and they fucking swing me back up on the roof. And they look at me and says, go back down the ladder and come back up again now. So I do it. I listen to them right away. They did that because, or else I would have been like, even like my fear of heights, I would have been frozen up on the roof. Like, I was like, they knew that because they had experience and they knew that was my first time. And I looked at
OTW, I don't think you're actually paying attention to what's really going on right now, which is like O'Shea hanging out somewhere and bumping I Want It That Way. Like we're really kind of taking it back to the, what is that, the 90s, early 2000s?
Is that Justin Bieber? Or not Justin, Justin Timberlake?
Don't act like you don't know who that is, bro.
Was it NSYNC or?
Don't do anything where you don't know what's going on. Like, that's not your jam on some level. Like, you're not singing it in your own head right now. Cut it out.
Yeah, it's not the fucking Starbucks. I have a portable speaker.
Yeah, you should get yourself a mic now, Brian. I think you're at that point, man. You should. Somebody should donate you a mic. I mean, I should donate you a mic. I have so many of them.
Yeah.
Now I can see that Jack's falling apart in the way that he used to be. Yeah. Come on, OTW. Give me the background.
What's that song?
Oh, wait. I want it that way, man. Come on. Everyone knows that fucking song. That's like supermarket music, like hits right there. Like, that's the reason I go to the supermarket for all the hits.
Okay. Hold on a sec. I got it.
Yeah, this is going to be your song that you're going to collaborate with Brian O'Shea and Snappy Snaps on. Talcott's version of I Want It That Way. I want it my way, brothers and sisters.
Okay, here it is. There you go. Your wish is my command.
All right, I want it that way, but as Jack Talcott.
You just sing it now.
I don't know it. I don't know it like that.
You are my.
He doesn't even put the words out.
One biz. Oh yeah, you want the words?
To live without peace, man, because I want it to my way.
All right. So, do you want the words so you can actually?
You got to give me the words. All right, I think so. I can. I got to do it on the fly. We're doing it on. Do it live.
Yes, sir. Here it is. There you go. Boom.
Come on, O'Shea. It's Talcott.
Gotta start. You are my guru.
Full enslaved is my fire, my one. Desire, believe, brothers and sisters, when I say I'm gonna have it my way. This is really a song about me and Jack. We're two worlds apart. I can't reach your heart, man, when you say, Jack, I can't have it my way. Tell me why.
Tell me why I can't live inside my house.
Tell me why I never want to hear you say you're evicted from the house. You can't have it your way.
I know it's true.
Oh, man. I know it's too late to pay this bill, man, but I want it my way.
I can't live in my house. Tell me why.
Hold on, you gotta stop it. Cleveland's throwing tomatoes. Cleveland's throwing tomatoes. He's not into it. Yeah, when my African American says cut the music, you cut the music, right? He's my guideline.
Yeah, he is the producer over here on OT.
Got a little too white in here for a second. He's my guideline. Got to keep us on track.
I pretty much listen to what Rob says too, when I have a chance or when I see his comments. Sometimes he's like, he goes all out. He goes, "What the fuck are you doing, OTW?" I was like, "Okay, I got it."
What are we not doing? That's the thing, right? What are we not doing over here?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we should do a lot less, and people should give more. There we go.
Right.
Isn't that the Talcott?
Expect more, do less. That's one of my talking points. It's one of the tenets of Talcottianism.
Oh, yeah. Don't you love it, Brian? All right, let's drop a link. We still have like another half hour to go before Paul. Hey, I was asking, thinking, are you going to go live like around 3:30? I got the fuck. I got to get to work.
Yeah, Brian O'Shea, what are you up to? What do you want to do today?
No, I'm probably just going to be wrapping. You're going live in what, half hour?
Yeah, that would be really good. Half an hour from now would be perfect.
Brian O'Shea does this thing now all of a sudden where he doesn't want to be a part of whatever I'm doing. He's like, I got stuff to do, bro. When are you going live? That's exactly when I have shit to do. Sorry. I'm important. I got my own thing going. See how quick that was?
I would like to jog and do some exercise, but I could come over, feel it out. You know, maybe we'll get into it in the beginning. But if it turns into where I'm just going to end up sitting there silent for hours.
I mean, you could bill me for the hourly rate. I know you're getting paid gigs now, so I get it. If you want to just bill me for the hourly rate, I'll square up with you.
Yeah, no, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, yeah, I'll come over in the beginning, get the ball rolling, and then we'll see who shows up, and we'll take it from there. But I would like to exercise at some point, do some shit. But yeah, we can start off with that.
Cool thumbnail.
That's the goat of all media.
The goat of all media. Oh, Christos is back. What's up, Christos?
Hey, ready for another?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, I am. I am ready. This is a great thumbnail, very hilarious. But I just want to ask Brian if he's still on his semen retention journey at this point, now that he's not smoking and he's on this momentum with the YouTube stuff.
Not creepy at all. You know, just be more graphic about it if you want. You guys want to know my fucking masturbating fucking schedule?
No, not really. There's a difference. You know what I'm talking about.
We know your masturbation schedule early and often.
Nah, but now that I'm like feeling myself, getting in shape, getting these opportunities and doing things, like I have been checking out the ladies a little bit more, and there's some hotties around, so my juices are flowing a little bit more, so probably be a little bit more, how do I phrase it, some releasing of whatever.
Whoa. Get.
Can I think of a better way to...
O'Shea, would you say I'm a better looking man than Howard Stern?
Oh yeah, absolutely. He's.
Thank you.
One of the ugliest, but that, I mean, he's like one of the, he's a known ugly person. I mean, well, OTW, that'd be a better question.
Well, listen. Well, OTW's known for being strikingly good looking all of a sudden. When did that happen?
Oh, he's known for being
when did that happen? Ugly. Who said that?
Oh, who thinks I'm known for being ugly? So I'm saying it's ugly versus ugly.
I was pretty sure, you know, Paul kept saying that I was like, you know, not attractive. So I kind of believed him. Figured he had a great.
That's what I'm saying. You guys missed
the keen sense and of what people like, you know, how attractive they are. And I figured, like, yeah, well, he might be right. Maybe I am not as good looking as I think I am. But I guess that all depends on perspective, right? I mean, I guess
you about the video you showed yesterday.
I mean,
OTW
Jaguar Wright finds you attractive, Brian. So that says a lot.
Despite you being ugly. OTW, you're still not as ugly as Howard Stern.
Right.
I'll take that as a compliment, Brian. Thank you very much for your generosity and your fucking...
It's just your ugliness, really. I wasn't like, oh, this is an ugly person. I never really thought about it until you started making thumbnails and none of them looked right. And they all looked
weird. They all look odd looking. Yeah. And then you start to come to the conclusion, maybe he's odd looking. It's not the thumbnail.
Right. Yeah, people can't pull off a Spock like me.
Well, I just know OTW, I've told myself for a long time that you can't have it all in life, right? You can't be funny, intelligent, you know, of good humor, good conversationalist, musician. I could go on about myself, not you, OTW. But about myself, right? I could go on. But I can't also be insanely good looking, right? That was just fucking stacked deck against everyone else. So I accept that position.
Right, because then nobody would have any chance anymore, right?
Right. It's like all the pussy would have to go to me.
Yeah. And then there would be jealousy, and you know, it would just like, it would cause chaos. The world would fucking end, you know. You know, it's like the butterfly effect. Like one beat of the wings of a butterfly in the desert can cause a fucking tornado.
Yeah, they see the move down there. I force myself to like have no way out of singing, and then once I get into it, I go, I got to get out of this. See what I do to myself. I do that for the medium. I regularly force myself, like indirectly, subconsciously, but I know what I'm doing when I'm doing it. And then I go, why am I doing this to myself right now? I'm like, well, it has to happen.
Talking about singing is, I was thinking about you fucking like, I put some music, like I come up with a fucking like a really good fucking beat backing track, and then you'd like rap on it from your side. But I don't know if you have any recording software, right? But if you don't, I do, and I can actually send you some software, which is fucking super user friendly. You have to be an idiot not to be able to use this one. You know, it's like, it's super simple to use, and you could actually import the music track that I'd send you. You could actually record your, you have a mic, so you're all right. You just, all you'd have to do is record your vocals, send me back the two tracks individually, and then bam, I could fucking produce it and master it, and we'd have a song, man. I'd even get back vocals in there, the chorus going. We'd really fucking actually make a real song, man.
Yeah, I know. I know Brian had wanted, when I was first talking smack about Brian's music, when he started to show it that one day on your channel, we were going through it all. And I was talking smack. I know he had said, you know, he wanted me to, you know, put something up. So whether I go to that extent with you, OTW, or I just pull something up and record it and post it, you know, this is pretty fun, pretty hype. So, you know, I think I might have to make my verse for Charles Wise, or, you know, do something with you behind the scenes, since you know, you're somewhat savvy with the music stuff. So there's a couple.
All right, Christos, you gotta practice right now. Throw up that song with the really monotone voice guy who says, "I'm too sexy for my shirt. So sexy it hurts."
No, can't do that, Paul. I'm sorry.
I see why. Okay, why can't he do that? This is what I mean. I don't work with bro. I can't work with people who can't take direction. Right. I didn't say get on the casting couch and take your clothes off. I said you got to sing "I'm Too Sexy," that song from the 90s. It's a well-known song, man. If you can't do that, you can't do anything.
Yeah, we didn't come to sing today. Nope.
See, yeah, okay. So, like, what's the Boy Scout motto, right? Besides, like, use protection with the older Scoutmasters. The other motto is, and it's kind of similar, be prepared. Okay? So, what, did he just run? You just ran because you like can't, you had the balls to show up here today. Want to talk some shit. And then when I tell you, okay, we got something for you, we got the stage ready, I'm not prepared. It's like Brian O'Shea, stand up on a Monday night. Shows up. He's number 50th in line. It's time to go. He says, who likes long nipples? Who's into croutons? Shit like that. Christos, get back here. If he doesn't get back here right now and do this song for everybody, he's not allowed back on any panel. He's restricted from all paneling activities. That's the new rule. New rule. I just made it. All right. He's not back yet. He obviously doesn't want to be allowed on panels anymore.
I mean,
Brian O'Shea, you want to do a little "I'm Too Sexy" or what?
Yeah.
Brian O'Shea will show you how it's done. Fuck slave. You just don't have the goods. You're not a star. You're not a performer. You're not Brian O'Shea.
Yeah.
Go ahead, OTW. Give him the give him the background.
Okay, I'll give you the background. What was it?
Yeah, take that disgusting picture off. I don't know why you gave me that to use the thumbnail. It's hard. It's grotesque. It's really disconcerting. So yeah, it's "I'm Too Sexy for My Shirt," karaoke version. But we need the real, I need like the full effect. Because sometimes they give you the light version karaoke, and then you got the full effect.
It's Paul Stern.
All right, please.
All right. All right, Ixtos. He's getting his giraffe ready, Ice Girl says.
Yeah, he's part of the Mason's gay division. He's a Gayson. And he doesn't ride the goat, he rides the giraffe. It's a gay Mason thing. If you know, you know.
Why did you leave, man? Come on, man. Couldn't run with the bit, dude. Is it me or people just don't see it when it happens? They right away take it as like, oh no, he's gonna rip on me. I gotta run.
Yeah, the problem is Cleveland doesn't get it, right? His blackness, that's the thing about black folks. He's got this governor, right? It's like a blackness governor, and it doesn't allow him to understand why white people would come online and do karaoke. And I tried to explain to him, this is how you get out of the box of fear and comfort. This is how you do something wacky and goofy and crazy that really doesn't have any effect on you and allows you to get out of that box of fear and comfort zone. So there's like a reason, there's a method to the madness, right? It's not like I woke up today and necessarily said, hey, I want to like throw on I'm Too Sexy for my shirt. It just kind of happened, bro. You know, it's like I didn't want to be attracted to Rob Cleveland. It just kind of happened, you know, and as long as it's a limited thing. It's like, I'm not gay. That doesn't happen anywhere else in my life. You know, so we come on here, we just kind of let it fly. We're fluid and dynamic. We let it roll. And then there he goes down there. Oh, it's about the delay. Oh, it's delayed. It's not about that, bro. That makes it better. Because then it's horrible. It's not even on cue. It's so bad that it's good, right? And then Brian O'Shea gets to jump out of his comfort zone and at Starbucks and just start yelling, I'm too sexy for my shirt. We get to see where that goes. What is it you don't get about? See, black folks not great with content. They're so busy looking for respect and other shit that like content, it just, they're not good with it. That's why Charleston White's been so great with content at times, because he just doesn't give a fuck. You know? From the black perspective, we're talking blackness now. Is Brian O'Shea's an expert, Lord of the Blacks, he calls himself. Your thoughts, Brian O'Shea?
Yeah, you got to be willing to bomb, even if it's on OTW streams, singing music.
Right, you're like the Muslim of comedy. You got to be willing to just get out there and just blow everything up, bomb, and not give a fuck how badly you die.
Right.
In order to live, you got to be willing to die.
All right, are you gonna give him the too sexy or what? I know Brian O'Shea needs to jump out of his comfort zone and fear right now. I can feel it. I know he's dying to do it. He finds value in that, like I do, and he's at a Starbucks. So can we get the shot? Can we get the long shot of everyone else around you while you do that? Possible to set that up. Can we get a second camera with you? I never have anything going on around me, and people only want to see one angle of me at best, if that. But you, we need two cameras, the Brian camera and then audience camera. And really, I want you to really sell it, right? I want everyone in that Starbucks to be like, if there's somebody in here right now who's sexy, it's probably going to be Brian O'Shea.
They're either going to tell me never to come back.
Well, listen.
Podcast studio.
Stop right there. What'd they tell Richard Pryor many times at many venues? Don't fucking come back. What'd they tell Red Fox? Don't come back. Okay. We're going to get right into it. Let's go.
You ready? All right.
He's fucking ready. He was born ready.
But my Talcott, I'm too sexy.
Well, yeah. If you want to use a Talcott mask and avoid the humiliation a bit, you can work with the mask. I'll allow it. Well, if we do at those parties, you know, put the mask on. You won't feel the shame as much.
Too sexy for my work. Fuck.
Bastard.
Too sexy for Milan.
Come on.
Fuck, I am in a Starbucks.
New York,
Japan.
Come on, type up. You're fucking homeless and drink urine. You don't give a fuck. Own it.
Too sexy for your body. I am nervous. Too sexy the fuck a model, and don't really turn. I'm a cat.
Wait a second. You're a sexy little model?
I don't know. It is,
Yeah, you're a sexy little model. You do a turn on the catwalk. That's kind of fucking, that's interesting. I like that.
I'm right.
Here you go. Come on.
Great.
Too sexy for the car I live in. Too sexy for the car I live in. Too sexy by far for the car I live in. Come on.
Sexy for the cash. I'm poor. What about that? Not a model. I don't. The words are
too sexy for this Starbucks. Too sexy for homelessness. Too sexy for the urine. I'm a model and a comedian. I do my fucking turn on the catwalk.
I'm sexy for a home. Too sexy for a...
I'm a model, you know what I mean, and I do a little turn on the catwalk.
Coming at you. For all the audiologists out there.
Push on the catwalk.
I'm sexy for a home. Too sexy for a home. Pussy in the car. Sexy for a home.
It's getting depressing. You might not want to read that part. It's hitting a little too close to home. It's Jack Talcott's song. My home and my love are going to leave me. Oh, man. See, that was great. Come on, Cleveland. You can't deny that was fucking great.
That was absolutely fun, man.
We're having fun here, man. What?
Brian's looking around himself to see if he's bothered anybody.
You know, they just heard that. It doesn't matter how low he was. They just heard I'm Too Sexy music and him singing it, mailing it in. Like, we're pretty sure the homeless guy came in here to, and sang I'm Too Sexy in the corner real low and creepy. Like, it would have been less creepy if you just went all the way with it. Like, right.
Dude, I think the girl behind me was filming it.
When you just like went back like this and looked around and see there was people watching, it's just like that was it. Oh, you just fucking put the cherry on the sundae, bro.
Pretty sure the girl behind me was filming it.
Oh God, I'm gonna
die. All right, I think my work here is done. I'm gonna go in the back and prepare. Great stuff. And I love that sexy model thing, do my turn on the catwalk. That's
oh God. Oh, thank God this broadcast's ending in 10 minutes. Hey man, you have anything you like to add to that, Brian, before we end the show?
Nah, man. Appreciate you having me up. And good to hear that you're on a path of inspiration and the momentum. So keep doing your thing, bro.
Awesome, man. Thanks a lot. And same to you, man.
OTW, I'm going to push it back to probably around 2. So if you want to invite some miscreants up or go over some other, you know, material, whatever.
Oh, well, I'm going to like disappear like around. I can let it run. I could. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'll try and figure something out, but I'm going to have to end it.
All right. Oh, yeah. You got to go, right?
Yeah. That's why I wanted to end it at 3:30 so I can fucking prepare. I have to get to work by 4. And it's
no doubt.
So that's pretty much what was I going to do. But I can still let it run. If anybody wants to join, I can, let the panel go till for an extra
You could always end it when you were planning to, and I'm live anyways. I could do my black paneling.
Throw it over to O'Shea, and then he can fucking do his bit for a bit, and then we can. O'Shea, you coming over with me or what?
Yeah,
don't be shy.
In the beginning, for sure. And then I gotta see how it goes, and then I gotta.
Yeah, you gotta tell Snafu Snaps you love him anyway, and forgive him for his hateful ways.
Right, I agree. Yeah, we'll do.
Right, so I guess I can do that too.
you could restream mine. You could end yours whenever you were going to end it. Restream mine the way I'm restreaming yours.
Well, actually, no. What I was going to do is just like maybe portal it over to your broadcast, I guess.
That's what I meant, like portal. I don't know what the term is. Because what am I doing with yours on my channel?
It's portal. We'll use portal. I guess portal is like pretty much, it's like a, you know, you portal people over to, let's say, a wormhole or something. It's like, whoop, the audience gets fucking zapped over to the other fucking broadcast, which I think is fucking cool, man, actually. It gives it a little kind of like a television aspect to it, you know, like back in the day when, you know, like they transfer over to the next show, you know, you get a commercial and then boom, they'd start the next show, right?
Kind of like, how Netflix does it too. Netflix kind of brings right up the next episode on it.
Right. I think that's really fucking cool because it brings it a feel of having a network, like a TV station, if you will, you know, where you have, you know, different, you know, shows during the broadcast during the day. And like, you know, like I'm portaling, let's say, over to you, and then you would portal over to Paul's afterwards. And, you know, what would actually be good is like after Paul would portal his audience over to another. This is it. The problem is there is no other. Fuck. If we, you know, at least if there was another one of us fucking having a broadcast.
I'm not doing it. You already got more than I want to do. And it's not personal to you guys. It's I've had dozens of people in the past who abuse me in every way. And I'm not doing it. And like you just said, O'Shea's a morning guy. You're in the morning. I'm not giving the audience to Slave Cot. I already did that. I'm not giving the audience to Pathetic Warrior. I already did that. You know, I'm taking a risk networking with folks who, again, Brian O'Shea and I have had this game in the past at one time. The difference with him is at some point he goes, okay, this is ridiculous. It's going nowhere. He's at least smart enough to go, if he gets caught up, this is probably not going to be beneficial for me or anyone. Let's just move forward. Right? So, like, again, I they could say that I'm narcissistic or whatever. Okay, great. For me, it's protective over myself, what I've created, the audience, in a sense, because you have to earn your listener here. And even just having them go to you or Brian O'Shea and working with you, it's like, I then got to leave at some point and you got to do something with it. If not, then they wind up looking at me like, why the fuck are you bringing us over to this shit? And then they start looking at me side-eyed about what I'm doing. So I don't know if you can understand that or that makes sense, but like, I'm willing to work with folks who are willing to work with me and then got something to offer. Once we go there, like once I start seeing Brian getting into more conversations and having more energy, and then, you know, willing to kind of, you know, go back and forth, then it's like there's something there for me to invest in, right? It's like folks got to have something for me to want to invest in. I already did too much of breaking my own rules of political correctness or just working with people who are next to me, right? Who I really may not respect or don't think that they're of good character.
And that's why it's actually, you know, pushing me to bring up my game at that level where I can actually contribute, you know, either in your broadcast and even there in my own broadcast where I do have a fucking an exchange with you and codded and allotted.
Yeah, I put that up so you could screen them.
All right. What's up, codded and allotted?
My family won't come back to me. I shit on Paul, and I just don't know what to do. So I come here for Paul and OTW and O'Shea's life coaching.
That's Jack. Jack, how are you, Jack? I was waiting for you to come up on panel.
Paulie boy, what are you doing?
Paulie boy, he has a new nickname for me, Paul, old Paulie boy, right? When it seems like he's a little bit upset sometimes, but that's his new nickname for me. Jack, how are you doing? It's good to see you here, finally. Yeah.
Get out of your fucking imagination.
What do you mean, get out of my... I didn't even imagine a disagreement yet. I think that's you. I think you're doing that.
That could be me. It could be OTW.
Or wait a second. OTW, did you just do that? Did you just imagine a disagreement and put it right in the middle of me and Jack Talcott? You would do something like that. Jack loves me and you don't.
Can we get back to love?
No.
Right. That's exactly what I was just saying. Like, let's get back to love. How Jack loves me and I love him, and you just tried to imagine a disagreement and put it right in the middle of us. I felt that. But I felt it.
I'm an asshole like that sometimes. I just do these things. You know, and sometimes
that's definitely you. An asshole.
It seems like you right now. It kind of does. Like, I didn't see it, but it feels like it.
Come on, Jack.
That's you. I
mean, be real, Jack.
I will go to the UN and I will fucking make moves and we will love and stop wars. And that's how it's going to be because I am a life coach.
Did you come up with a new branding or did you did you take another brand from someone, caught it and allotted? I don't think I've seen that one before.
Yeah, I think caught it and allotted will be my new thing because live without fear. I'm starting to fear my daddy. That's why I call him Polly Boy when I'm mad because, you know, I'm feeling my life coach thing ain't working. So I'm here at OTW and Brian you O'Shea and Paul and Slade to get life coaching lessons.
Wow, this is like this is a new leaf, Jack saying he's turning over.
Yeah.
That's you.
Wait, what's him? No, me or him?
Great stuff, man. Great stuff. It was great. I loved it. That was a good bit.
Great man, he left us sort of a cliffhanger there because he said that's you, but we never found out who and what and how and why.
Christos is sorry, back. Did Bobby you come back for the meeting? Did you come back to sing the song?
I will if you guys want. It's just I'm about to get off work here, so it was a bad time earlier. But you know I'm about the bits, bro. I'm not worried about that type of nonsense. But I won't. I did come up to talk about rap, but you know
you're not gonna wizard us, are you? And saying it's a U.S. code that says you can't do it again.
Well, it's funny you brought that up about wizard. That dude was trying to flex like he's
all right. Listen, you just fucking feel the intro just, right here, okay? Never mind about that. Just get ready to do what you need to do.
Just fast talk.
I'll give you a second to prepare.
All right, I'm here.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
All right, go.
I'm too sexy to do my live streams in a cordial manner on time. I'm too sexy for all my clothes in general. I'm too sexy to make these rhymes work. I'm too sexy to live without fear. Shit. I'm too sexy. I'ma have to tip for Christy Lee dolls. Oh, me so horny, that two live crew, that's got to be. I do not read these lyrics, so fast I'm like me, Wiz. The only thing that's left for me to fuck around, I might start a real rap now. But I'm just pacing around, outside, upside down, my mind gone down. About to start that fast talk like wizard, and how does that dude think he can rap? I'ma go do right there. If you wanna go catch me then, I'ma have to do it not to this. Cause this ain't shit. Alright.
Yeah, you got it. You still gotta do the I'm too sexy those again. I'm too sexy for my car. Too sexy for my car. Too sexy baba. I'm too sexy for my hat. Oh come on, man. Now I'm the one who's stuck doing the fucking it's like, come on. All right, that's it. No, we've already did this. Christos did his bit, guys. He owned up to his bit thing. So I'm going to end it, actually. You know, it's like, why? No, I'm not going to end it. What the fuck time is it? 3:30. Okay, so it's right on the dot. Wizard, stop acting like a little girl. Yeah, I agree, Lubaz. You're right. Wizard should stop acting like a little bitch. I even said, it's like, you know, the door's open, man. Come back. Stop being like a bitch and, you know, fucking come correct, man. How many times have you, you know, people have been offered to come correct and, you know, just like spit on it?
Yeah, I don't know what you're going to do, but if you do end it, you can send it my way and I'm going to hit it going on my black panel.
One sec. He pushed it off till 4. Hold on. Let me get over to your broadcast here. Where is it? I know Shay. There you are. I know Shay. How come you have? I don't get it. You got like two lives going at the same time?
I'm portaling yours, not live. You know when you hop in, like if you hop into my StreamYard or however you portal it.
Right. Yeah, I know. I'm just like wondering which live you got two lives on your channel.
The one that doesn't say OTW News.
Now where the fuck am I? What the fuck? Okay, that's weird. Okay, and you got how many people watching? Six people watching right now?
Okay,
that's weird. All right, I got it. That's that. What I'm going to do now is go to my fucking broadcast. Change the portal options. Personalize. Go to portal. Delete that one. There. Copy paste the link here to that. There we go. Let's see how that's going to work out. Yeah, there we go. That worked. Boom.
You just drop, all right. You drop portal,
the portal is set. So everybody will be Brian O'Shea's.
You could drop a link to my channel too and chat if you want.
Where am I? This is your channel. All right, pause.
What do you say about my
back over here? Drop the link. We got Miss Mona backstage right now. Oh, let me screen this for a second. All right, Miss Mona, welcome to the show.
Hey, Brian. Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I spelled your name wrong backstage. I saw you over in another live, and I decided to subscribe to you.
Oh, cool. I appreciate that.
No, my pleasure. No, because I saw you speaking. You're doing like some race divide thing. I find it fascinating. But go ahead with your commentary.
I think I ran into you on a black panel the other day, right? Yeah, that's you.
That's right, because I'm half caste, like half black, half white. I use white men as slaves and so on. And I really liked your commentary. It was fascinating.
Yeah, you were quite rude to me, that black panel.
Well, you know, I have to show some resistance. Anytime a white male speak like he's some KKK member, I have to be like, ugh, you know, whatever. Bye, fuck white men. So are you a KKK member?
Who? Brian?
Brian. Yeah, I was wondering. Is he one?
I doubt it.
He's not.
Of course not. Well,
yeah, so
I don't want to speak for him. I was like,
oh, okay. No, because they were saying that in the chat, and I was like, I'm not going to cast him away so quickly. I like white men, so I want him to be one of those white men that I'm getting wrong. So the way you came across was, you know, I thought you're a bit racist. Are you racist?
Well, this is what I go through all day in Black Panther. I mean, we could continue these shenanigans at my table, my stream. I think you're getting ready to wrap up, right, OTW?
Yeah, I'm about to end it. I was going about to pop up my my video that I made yesterday, and after that, end the show. So,
yeah, okay. So, thank you very much for the stream, OTW News.
Yeah, well,
come over to my stream.
Thank you for being here, and you're always welcome back.
Thank you very much. And the panels. Hold on, too. Okay, Brian, did you say you're going to go live next?
I am live right now. So we can continue this over there. So come on over there and we do your little dick over there, okay?
I can shake my tail feather over there, yeah? All right, then. Thank you very much, Brian O'Shea. And thank you very much, OTW News. Please donate, subscribe if you can. Salute. Good night, guys. I'll be soon back with you.
Peace out. All right, that was cool. I like those interactions where it's actually authentic and there's no fucking porn bomber showing the stuff. He says, play my video, TW. I'll send you $10. Joseph Aquaviva. All right. I guess drop a link then.
I'm gonna head over to...
All right, go ahead, man. Get the hell out of here. Go prepare your chat for for a, let me see a what fucking snaps. Raid.
Let's see what snaps.
Hey, on a serious note, did you see those videos I put out on the Bridge Optics OTW?
No, I didn't.
I recommend you go check out some of the things happening in the world right now.
All right, man.
See you guys later.
That out for sure. All right, peace all out, right. Brian.
Later, Brian.
All right, come on over, Snap.
All right. You got me blocked on your main channel.
Blocked from chat?
Yep. I'm Nazi codded.
I don't know how to figure that out right now, but come up on the panel. Come up on the stream anyways.
Joseph, drop right. The link, dude, or come up on panel, drop it backstage. You don't have to show up on panel or anything. You know, we can stay backstage and drop the link backstage because I'm not too fond on giving mods just for...
Oh, he's talking about the Bridge shit, too. Interesting.
Got a four-minute video.
I put some pretty serious stuff on the Bridge shit, Mr. OTW, like very connections, linked to the Obama movie. Things to that nature, White Lion, 33, Mason numbers, agendas in play.
All right, so I need the link. Please, Joseph, come on, click. Hold on, I'll drop the link for you so you can come on upstage if you're looking for one. Just click the StreamYard link, come backstage, copy paste that link for that video that you have in private chat, and I will. Play it. There we go. What's this video? What's that video, Snaps?
Oh, that's the old one. That one's okay. Actually fucking. You ever need some spare time? Play that shit. It's Rockstar. It's not my Bridge shit though. Joseph, get up here.
I need that link. Hold on, let me go check out your channel. I guess I'm gonna have to do all the heavy work myself. Damn it. Where's my fucking broadcast? Damn it. Oh, there we go. Okay, go ahead, drop that link, bro. I am waiting. There it is. All right. Okay, so hold on a sec. I fucking know this movie. Oh, it's going to be interesting. Great stuff, man. I'm glad you decided to come up and share it. After all, hold on a sec, man. I always fuck up when it comes to this part. Hold on a sec. Did you want to come up on stage or are you just going to, you know, hang out backstage? Just mention that in back check. And if you want to come up on stage, I'll bring you up. Okay. So,
yeah, I was just skimming through his video. He's covering a lot of the things we were talking about, the Obama movie. So this, it'll be pretty good. In my videos, it's the same stuff. It's going also, this cargo ship had hazardous materials. They're not talking about as well.
All right, you guys ready? Here it goes.
Hey guys, welcome back. It's Joseph. In 2023, the Obamas produced a movie called Leave the World Behind, where a cyber attack causes a massive container ship to lose power and crash. Months later, a massive container ship loses power and crashes into the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore, causing a deadly collapse. Obama's movie hit Netflix on December 8th. This bridge collapse happened on March 26th. So the bridge collapsed 109 days after Obama's movie, which is about a cyber attack. In gematria, cyber attack equals 109. So no what way. Are the odds? That bridge collapsed 109 days
it's so deep,
after
dude.
Obama's movie. Which begins with a cargo ship losing power and cyber attack equals 109. I mean, wow. What another huge confirmation Guys, please share this with everyone you can. This is absolutely undeniable. The cargo ship lost power. Remember, the lights were flickering. Loses power, hits the bridge collapses. 109 days after Obama's movie, which is about a cyber attack and the power grid going down, right? This happens 109 days after the movie, Cyber Attack 109. Wow. And don't forget what we've already connected to Obama's movie. The Francis Scott Key Bridge, it collapsed at 1:28 a.m. In gematria, bridge collapse equals 1:28.
No fucking way. The bridge
was named after Francis Scott Key. The bridge collapsed 128 days before Francis Scott Key's birthday. It happened in Maryland. Maryland equals 1:28. In the movie Leave the World Behind, it's the cargo ship named White Lion. White
Lion, yeah, I remember that.
Power. White Lion equals 1:28. And that same cipher, power grid, equals
there's more to that White Lion thing, too.
Obama's movie came out on 12/8, December 8th, 1:28. And the bridge collapsed 128 days after Joe Biden's birthday. Now, what we discovered yesterday, 128 minutes into Obama's movie, Leave the World Behind, there's a bridge collapse. I mean, wow. 2 hours and 8 minutes into the movie, which is 128 minutes, there's a bridge collapse.
Wow.
And then don't forget the container ship that hit the bridge. It was named Dali after Salvador Dali, who has a famous painting called The Broken Bridge and the Dream, which equals 128. So you put all that together, 128 minutes into Obama's movie, there's a bridge collapse. White Lion, 128, Power Grid, 128. The movie came out on 12/8. Bridge collapse, 128. 128 days before Francis Scott Key's birthday, the bridge collapsed at 1:28 a.m. Wow. And it was 109 days after Obama's movie hit Netflix, Cyber Attack 109. Wow. Guys, please like, comment, share, subscribe. Please share this with everyone you can. I mean, this is absolutely undeniable. And keep looking up, guys. We are living in the biblical end of days. Jesus is coming very soon. I can't wait. And I'll see you guys on the next video. God bless.
Hey OTW. Can you play the one I just dropped? Because he went over the numbers.
I gotta get the fuck out of here.
Okay, can you put it link? He went over the numbers, which is incredible. I should have fucking gotten that. It's cool because the stuff I went over was the symbology with the 3-3 on the ship, and then of course I went into the Dali backwards means deceive and stuff like that. I didn't know it was so, like, I figured it was gematria like that, but it's crazy.
All right, Snaps. See you tomorrow, everybody.
I'm going to find you a Jew. We're going to get you signed.
All right, man. Peace out.
Something's got a hold of me lately. No, I don't know myself anymore. Feels like the walls are all closing in, and the devil's knocking at my door. Whoa, whoa. Out of my mind. How many times did I tell you I'm no good at being alone? Yeah, it's taking a toll on me, trying my best to keep from tearing the skin off my bones. Don't you know I lose control when you're not next to me? I'm falling apart right in front of you, can't you see? I lose control when you're not next to me. Yeah, you're breaking my heart, baby, you make a mess of me. Problematic. Problem is I want your body like a fiend, like a bad habit.
bad habits hard to break when I'm with you. Yeah, I know I can do it on my own, but I want the real full moon, black magic, and it takes two. Problematic. Problem is when I'm with you, I'm an addict. I need some relief. My skin and your teeth can't see the forest for the trees. You got me down on my knees, darling, please. I lose control when you're not here with me. I'm falling apart right in front of you, can't you see? I lose control when you're not next to me. You're breaking my heart, baby, you make a mess of me. When you're not here with me, I'm falling apart right in front of you, can't you see? I lose control when you're not here with me. You're breaking my heart, baby, you make a mess of me.
I can see you over there staring at your drink, watching that I sink alone tonight. And chances are you're sitting here in this bar, cause he ain't gonna treat you right. Well, it's probably not my place, but I'm gonna say it anyway, cause you look like you haven't felt the fire, had a little fun, haven't had a smile in a little while, baby. Cause blue looks good on the sky, looks good on that neon buzzing on the wall, but darling, it don't match your eyes. And I'm telling you, you don't need that guy. It's so black and white, he's stealing your thunder. Baby, blue ain't your color. No, no. I'm not trying to be another just pick you up kind of guy, trying to drink you up, trying to take you home. But I just don't understand how another man could take your son and turn it ice cold. Well, I've had enough to drink, and it's making me think that I just might tell you, if I were a painter, I wouldn't change you. I'd just paint you bright, baby. Cause blue looks good on the sky, looks good on that neon buzzing on the wall, but darling, it don't match your eyes. And I'm telling you, you don't need that guy. It's so black and white, stealing your thunder. Baby, blue ain't your color. No, no, no. Ooh. Ain't your color blue?
Looks good on that neon buzzing on the wall, but darling, it don't match your eyes. And I'm telling you, you don't need that guy. So black and white, you're stealing your thunder. Baby, blue ain't your color. Ain't your color, no, no. Come here, baby. Let me light up your world.